The following presentation is a gift from the team at Streamline Publishing, publishers of Fine Art Connoisseur, Plein Air Magazine, and weekly newsletters Fine Art Today, Realism Today, Plein Air Today, and American Watercolor, and events, the Plein Air Convention and the Figurative Art Convention. We offer over 400 different art instruction tutorials and ultra-high-quality video by the world's leading artists. If you like what you see, help us support our artists and our team with your purchase. Each video aired has a special discount code for today only in the comments section with a link to the video offered. And to see everything we do, or if you want to receive notice of new releases, new products, and new events for artists, simply click the other link, which says, "See everything we do." Thank you.
Hi there, I'm Eric Rhodes, publisher and founder of Fine Art Connoisseur and Plein Air Magazines, which you can find at Barnes & Noble or most newsstands nationwide. Thank you for tuning in. We're here every day at 3 p.m. and we're trying to keep your head in the right place by teaching you art. We have produced probably well over 600 art instruction videos, one of the largest libraries of art instruction in the world from the world's leading masters. And we're sharing pieces of those every day at 3. Today we have one called California Impressionism with the great Karl Dempwolf. I think you're going to enjoy this one.
Hi, I'm Karl Dempwolf, and I paint in oil. I usually start with a small pencil sketch on plein air, out in the open, where I love to paint. And then the labor starts by coming into the studio. And I'm here in the studio to show you some techniques and to remind you of something you know or don't know, and hopefully this will help you become a better painter. Now we're ready to start, and I'm going to lay out some paints. Some of them I've already salvaged from the paint box from this morning. Some alkyd white, a Winsor & Newton alkyd white. That's a relatively fast drying paint that I like. It's wet on wet, but tomorrow it'll be a painting that's already halfway dry. Next, a cadmium yellow light. Cad yellow light right here. An Indian yellow, which I really like. It's, again, some of these yellows and oranges end up looking almost identical, but they're not. They're totally different paints, especially the pures. The pures really go a long way. They go a long way, and you don't need much of it. Then I'm going to have some alizarin crimson, which I use with a dark blue to make a slurry to kind of block in the painting after I've made my sketch. A very light cadmium red, medium pure. A little bit of that. And then we're going over to, I've got the light green here. I'm going to put on a permanent sap green deep. I've got some here, but I'm going to add a little bit more because I'm going to need it. And there's a little phthalo green as well. And I like phthalo green in very, very small quantities. It's a powerful paint, and you won't need much. But I like it when I'm mixing it with my dark purples and Payne's gray to make my darkest parts of pine trees and things like that. And since we're going to have Monterey pines and other Point Lobos shrubbery, I will need it. And then I'm going to go to a cobalt blue and this happened to be a Rembrandt French ultramarine blue. And lastly, what else? Lastly, my Payne's gray, which is going to be used for my darkest darks. I can use black as well, but I've gone to Payne's gray mostly. Manet used black, and I kind of feel like I can use it too, but most plein air impressionists stay away from black because the impressionists in France didn't use it, and so I've kind of trying to get away from it, but I've used it when I need it. This is one of the books that I have used and recommend to my students. It's Edgar Payne's composition of outdoor painting. It's a wonderful resource, and that's one of the things that every person who wants to paint, wants to get better at painting or learn how to paint, is to get themselves not only Edgar Payne's book on outdoor painting, but also Kevin McPherson's Adding Color and Light to Your Paintings, and even Alla Prima by Richard Schmidt. There are other books as well, but I think resources like this are absolutely critical. We have a sketch here that I've done, and I've decided to make some changes. And this sketch is absolutely horizontal. It would make a great 16 by 20, but I've got almost a square format here. This is actually 16 by 18. And so I did a colored pencil sketch into a vertical, and then I've changed my mind again. And now it's not quite a square and no longer a horizontal, except by 2 inches. And now I'm going to have to try to transpose what I've got here and what I did here into this shape right in front of us. And so now that we've got our paints laid out, I've got my oil color sketch from Point Lobos and my colored pencil sketch, I'm going to work on trying to rearrange the masses so that they fit well onto this almost square format. This happens to be Luan board. It's very thin, an eighth of an inch. I've covered it with a canvas, and then I've primed it with an acrylic gesso. And in the acrylic gesso, I've put a California tint in, a brown or a reddish brown. It doesn't really make a difference. I just don't like white canvases, even though I've painted on them. I've put on this covering, and the reason I do the covering, this gesso and the tint, is that it makes the surface a little slicker. It makes the paint move quicker. Instead of being absorbed by all the little holes in raw canvas, the paint slides a little bit easier, and it makes it easier to paint. And that's the rationale for that, and it seems to have worked for me for a long time. So now we've got these large Monterey pines, and I like the mass that I've created here. It goes literally off, comes back down, has a grouping over on this side. The big trunk comes up into this area here. It's probably too wide as it is up on top. I see that I've put another grouping down below it, and I like that as well. And this grouping actually continues almost to the bottom. It has some skylights in it from what I see here, and I think that'll work well. But this trunk will go in front of this grouping of trees behind. And that grouping of trees isn't all green. It ends up having some lighter greens in the lower left-hand foreground. It doesn't have to be a pine. It could be a juniper, which is more on the yellow color. Then we have a slope that kind of comes down and a little pathway that drives the eye toward the painting, and that's what we want. I also think that, this trunk goes all the way down to here. And most of those trunks at Point Lobos are not the dark color that I've got here. They're much lighter. They seem to, wind and weather makes them a gray color, and so much of this will be a gray color. I've got another trunk kind of coming from behind it. Actually, they're all next to each other, one after another, but I think this is also the first time coming from the sketch, from the original pencil sketch, then the oil sketch. This is one of the first or second time that you can make changes. You can make changes to your design. And I'm a little concerned about where I'm going to put the next tree. It's here. And is it part of this grouping right here, or does it stand by itself? And if this stands by itself, then I need to separate it from the foliage in the background, this green in the background. So I've talked about this being a lighter yellowy green because it could be a juniper. Then we end up having a rock in this area. And the reason for a rock in this area is so that it plays on the rock that's on the right-hand side. And the rock on the right-hand side is going to be our horizon line is here. And this rock is going to be just about. We're in a pretty high location looking down, so this rock would be below. On my sketch, I have it almost at horizon level, but I want to bring it further down. It's here, here. It's got some, these are very warm and orangey rocks. When Franz Bischoff painted these in the 1920s, he made them almost a red, a golden red. This is the rock, and this one is gonna, the light is coming from this side over here, from the left to the right, so our highlights are gonna be on this side, the shadows are gonna be on the right. So this is the rock. This one does have some trees on it, so it's gonna get a small tree, which I don't have on my sketch, but it will be in this painting here. Most of the highlights are gonna be in this area right here. Water is gonna be spilling over these rocks in the foreground, and here it's going to be the darkest dark. It's going to be in this area with some reflection of this nice warm rock that's here. Now that we're laying it out, I said I was a little concerned about the extra tree trunk here, but I think that'll work itself out. I may put one trunk into this general mass over here, and that may just work out. But let's see if you can follow this. We've got some waves coming in here, water splashing over these little outcroppings. This is our massive rock. The lightest part will be here. The darker part will be here. There is another shorter tree up on top of this ridge, which I mentioned, but there's also one in the medium, in the middle foreground, which is going to be right here. It kind of balances all the trees I've got over there. It won't be as tall. It won't be as predominant, but it's going to be about in this area right here. It'll have some branches coming out and what have you. It'll block part of this rock in the background, but that doesn't bother me either. Continuing on with the sketch, I want to remind myself and those of you watching that on the right-hand side is where my shadows are going to be, and the deepest shadows are going to be in this area right here. I want to bring a shadow from the sun coming from this side. There'll be a shadow crossing this path that I've drawn in right here. There's going to be a shadow here. And I'm going to add another little tree, another little sapling of one of these Monterey pines. It's starting in this area right over here. There. Yeah, I think I'm ready to kind of make the outline of what I've done a little deeper. And I'm doing it with a little tiny number two Utrecht brush. And all I'm going to do is grab a little an ultramarine blue and the alizarin crimson and a little bit of my alkyd white so we know it's going to dry quickly. And so now it's dark enough for me to go over the design so that I'm going to look at it more critically once I do this. Also, I wanted to not make a straight line like I had. I want to make it a little bit more interesting. Here, there, this is part of that trunk. And this is the outline or the design of the mass. And it goes off the board, which is fine, and then comes around to here. Again, a little gamsol odorless terp, white, an alkyd white, which dries quickly. And I'm going to continue with the outline. There is a grouping underneath this larger tree. It goes pretty far down here. The darkest darks will be in this area over here. And I said I was going to add another trunk, which is fine. It can go back further, a little back toward the background. This is going to be the crown for that particular tree. And I'm going to have to make it separate from the various greens around it. We'll work on that when we get there. And here is going to be the rock, which is going to emulate or kind of tie the two sides together. Here's that rock. It's going to be on the light color with the darkest part of that rock over on the right-hand side. There's going to be this shadow from this trunk, which I'm going to make much lighter later on, but for now, just to make sure I know where it is and what is it supposed to be doing. is the shadow that comes, it runs across our little road, and it's the shadow of this trunk and part of the foliage here. This is foliage here, maybe another trunk that comes in here. Now, here, there, here's that smaller, younger tree that's kind of balances on the other side. The color is not really critical at this point. I just want to remind myself of what's what and where things are in relationship to each other, and maybe add some, leave the highlighted side of the tree alone and make the side that's in shadow a little bit darker. This is going to be a horizon line. We're looking literally down on the water. This is that wonderful cliff that we've got here. And the highlight will be here in the front. It will have a few highlights behind, but it'll be relatively dark. Also, this rock, this big orange piece of granite, as painted by a bunch of other people besides Franz Bischoff. I've done this a number of times. These rocks at Point Lobos are just my favorite places to paint. It is wild. It's unkempt. Nobody chops down trees when they fall, unless they're going to fall on someone that's walking on the many paths in that particular reserve in central California. It'll be just south of Carmel by a few miles. And if you haven't been there, it should be on your bucket list, especially if you're a painter. I'm ready to block in lightly, and we're doing thick over thin. That means you start very thin and get thicker as the painting develops. And it's a good rule to follow because it's easy to change things. If you make a mistake, which I often do, it's easy to erase and just wipe out what you've done. So thick over thin. Always start thin and get thicker. Use a lot of terp to make the paint nice and thin and flow easily. I'm using a Permalba white bristle brush, and I like them because they're tough. They're hard to find. They're hard to find, and the only place where I've been able to get them is on Amazon. Isn't that strange? But that's the life today. Amazon, you can get anything, and I got this brush there as well. So I'm going to, again, take a lot of terp, make up a little slurry, because this is going to be my tree. And I'm going to just very quickly block things in. Using my sap green, deep, a little bit of phthalo, a little bit of that wonderful red from Winsor & Newton. It says light red, but it's a very, very powerful red. Anyway, back to the trees. I can already tell I'm going to make the left side much, much lighter. And this will separate because I'm going to make this much lighter than this below. And the reason I'm going to do that is because the light is hitting that. Where is my nice? Here. This is going to be a much lighter color on this side, and I'm going to make this stuff underneath it, the tree that's underneath it here that I said I was going to have to watch to make sure I'm able to separate it from this. And by doing that, I'm going to go back in, and you've noticed I've not really changed brushes. I'm not cleaning my brush. Everything is so thin that it really doesn't make much difference. You really don't have to change your brush at this time. Later on, when things get more critical and you're trying to be exact, then it's probably a good idea to change your brushes. For now, it's not. Again, this thing will have a lighter green on top as well. I'm using that Rembrandt light green. I'm going to make it different than that tree above, so we end up having a different green here. And since I've got this light green, I like that green for this tree over here. Switch over, go back in with some nice darks, my Payne's gray. And I don't like this shape right here, so I'm going to make the shape more interesting. Don't want to make it too large, but I did want to make it more interesting. There's going to be a tree up here, and there's going to be a tree that we added kind of as an afterthought right down here to kind of balance all the greens that are here. Okay, let's continue with what I started here. And blocking in, because this is all trees, bushes, things that are in the background here. And again, as I'm coming up to this tree, I want to make sure it's darker, that we don't end up kind of getting these various masses kind of run into each other without separating. That's really critical. It really is critical to me, and I'll end up doing it by, let me tell you what will happen later on, because I may not remember to tell you that I'll actually line it. I'll actually make a line that separates this mass from this one. And yes, I'll go darker on this one near the bottom right here. Anyway, let me continue. That was just an interesting sidelight because it's kind of important. These are the trees that I've kind of hanging in this area are behind the large trunk that's here. And in this area, we end up having some grasses that are much yellower. You can tell that, again, from the sketch that I've got right here. I like this lighter yellow. It could be dead grasses, but it works well with the colors that I've got. I'm also going to, let's go in that light yellow. Let's do that right now so that I'll remember what I said I was going to do. Here, this yellowy area here. And above that yellow is going to be our rock that's going to emulate this rock over here. We're going to use a little bit of red. Yeah. Always a little bit of alkyd white. No, not right. I don't want it to look like this green. I do want to go more orangey. So I'm using some cad red, light, a little bit of orange, yeah, and a little bit more white. And I'm going to go back in here. This is going to be the warmest part of this rock right here, maybe another sliver of it in this area. And now I'm going to end up doing that rock opposite on this shore, similar to it. It'll have some shadows on it. It will not be as bright as this. It's near or by these large pines, so it will have similar, it'll have a similar color, but the value will be darker. So I'm going to get some more reds to darken it, because it is going to be partially in shadow. It will have some highlights on it to make sure we know it's part of this. And then I'm going to add, at this time, because I'm going to have, let's see, I've got an awful lot of water, and that's fine. If you're high looking down on the horizon line is going to rise up as well. If you're at sea level, the horizon line would be down here. So here we're pretty high up looking down, and the reason we see so much ocean is because we're so as high as we are. I'm going to end up adding some interesting clouds up here, and I'm going to go draw in some patterns of what will become clouds, I hope. And also, you've noticed that I'm painting the tree, and then I'm painting a rock, and then I'm going to paint the real dark as the water goes around this little peninsula here, this granite peninsula. And then all of a sudden, I'm painting the sky. One of the things that I think is important is that you don't work on this rock and finish that rock, because you'll want to change it, because later on it doesn't work with the stuff that's on the other side of the painting. So I'm working on all parts of the painting at the same time. A little bit of the grass, a little bit of the path that's going down, then it's the sky and the water and what have you. And then I said I was going to do a little block in for the clouds that I think we'll need in this sky. So I'm going to design a cloud that I think will work. Put it here, coming out from behind there. maybe another small one down here. And then I'll block it in so that I don't forget what the heck this is supposed to be. So here's my cloud, and oh yes, I've got paint on my brush that's coming off, and that's perfectly fine. There's nothing wrong with that. Here is a cloud that I think I'm going to like, but time will tell, because I do like changing my mind. And it may be too large, but we'll see about that later too. So here's another part of this cloud. They're kind of connected with things. And then I'm going to start immediately getting into the water. How light or dark do I want that water to be? And so I'll put in a tone of blue-gray. It's got some green in it already from the trees, and that's perfectly okay too. For now, it matters very little. For now, what's really important is, do I like how my masses work with one another? And if I do, I continue. If I don't, I stop. And it's easy to, because we're painting thick over thin, in other words, we're still painting thin, that we can erase it, scrape it out, and start from scratch. We're going to have some blue coming through there as well. The sky, I'm going to make a much lighter color. It'll be starting with cerulean, some white, and it's going to be much lighter than the water. But I'm just blocking it in for now, just to see how things work with one another. And if it works with one another, I continue. If it doesn't, I stop and make changes. Okay. And what's really critical is that I feel that I do this as quickly as possible. I've done my thinking with the designs and the shapes. And now what I want to do is, was I right in the choices I made and where these masses are, where the trees are, how big they are? Or do I have to make changes? And if I want to make changes, this is the time to do it, and not once I've got heavy paint on there. And I don't have to, this doesn't have to be everywhere and perfect, because, like I said, I only want to see, are things working or do I need to make changes? Yeah, that's right. It's getting a little weird color in here, but for now, that's working fine. I'll have to straighten that out. I need to make this business is all one color. And I certainly want to make the clouds lighter, too. Like I said, I work on every part of the painting almost simultaneously. And the object of there is that you learn not to finish the cloud, not to finish this tree, and not to finish the water, but put color everywhere of what you think the right color is, and do it thin, so that when you're done, you can say, yep, this is how I want to continue, or no, I've made a mistake here. And that's not unusual. That will happen. All right. Now, I said, so far, so good. I'm going to make this darker in a minute. It needs to be darker. This is too dark. But I'm going to paint this, and then some of the greens that are on there will come off, and those greens will end up going into the darks down in this area right here. There will be some greens, but basically very, very dark blues will go in here. This tree is now almost disappeared, and so we need to make it lighter so I don't forget about it, which is not unusual. I'm going to make it lighter here so I remember it's here. This is the shadow that comes across here. This is the water that's very dark in this area, and it lightens up and becomes this wonderful phthalo green. It's just really a brilliant color when you see it, especially in water that's clear. Here's what I wanted to do. Some of this color is kind of a phthalo green, and some of the white, the fast drying white. And as we go out, it'll become lighter and meet the blue Pacific here. This is our little tree. I'm going to make an outline around that tree so I Don't keep painting over it. It's going to be here. There. There. Okay. All right, I'm not terribly unhappy. But there. All right. Now, I said I'm going to make this darker. This has to be darker. I'm going to back to my deep sap green. This needs to be darker. I need to find, or I need to feel, that what I've done when I'm ready to really add paint to it is that I like the mass that I've created. Or, no, I don't like that little lump on the top of this tree. Or, yes, I do, and I'm going to put more of it on there. It's just looking at everything that I've done, every mass, from the sky to the cloud to the various elements that are in here, that I'm pleased with it, that I'm happy with it. And if I'm not, like I said, while the paint is still not dry and it's thin, it's easy to change. I also said that we're going to have some outcroppings of rocks right here. That's not the color I want, sorry. I want to go more toward yellow and orange. Yeah, this is where the highlights of this rock are going to be, right here. And I need to have some of that coming out into the ocean right here. Right there. Okay. And while I have this color, let me put a little bit of it on here. There. Yeah. Let me make this a darker color on the end here, which is part of that same rock. But it's darker down here, and it's going to have some shadows in it. And the shadows are because the sunlight is hitting it here. And yeah, it's not hitting it directly from the front. It is hitting it at the front, but also there are outcroppings that kind of protrude and catch the sunlight as it's coming from this side over here. And it's time for me to also put in some nice shadows in here. And I'll take that nice light red from Winsor Newton and my little Payne's gray and decide I'm going to end up having some shadows that are created from the sun angle that's coming from my left. So here we're going to end up having some shadows. That's that tree on top of this hill. And I've added some other things here, thinking I might like it. If I do, I'll leave it. If not, I will remove it. I'm going to put darker green over here. Again, as I'm looking at the painting, this doesn't make sense to me. I need to have a darker value there. Back to my greens, a little bit of phthalo green. Yeah, redo this shadow. One of the things that I've not done, and I'm going to redo, I'm going to erase some things here so you can see how easy it is to erase things at this time, and that is to put my road back in. And all I'm going to do is just get my brush. This was a number 6 Primalba that I just erased it, and then make the line that you think the little road that I had in here earlier needs to take. It goes here, makes a bend down below, kind of gets wider up on top. Here. There. There. And to make sure I don't forget it's there, I'll put a drop shadow in on one side. And this is the shadow from the tree. Too dark before, it's better now. And I'm going to fill that in on the left-hand side right over here with some of the grasses that we started to put in. Mm. there. Yeah. There's also, this line kind of continues all the way down. One of the other things, one of the other grasses that seem to be predominate this Point Lobos area, especially during the later parts of the year, during the fall, are these grasses that end up having this purpley look to it. And I'm going to put those in. It's not going to be all the same colored grass that I've got up here. Some of it is in shadow. Some of it ends up having a kind of a purpley look to it. And I get that by just using alizarin crimson and a little white and kind of paint around this bush. I want it to stand out. So I want this to stand out here. And once I use that purpley area down in this area over here, you know, I can't stop and just use it in this area. I've got to have it somewhere else as well, just so that it's not a total shock and surprise that all of a sudden there's some purple over on this side here. I think also I'm looking at this for now. This is a little on the dark side. There are also going to be, water has made, the surface made the bottom part of this rock. No matter how orangey it is near the top, down on the bottom here, where the water has splashed on it for centuries, it's going to end up being a darker color, with some highlights, of course. The few things that I've been thinking about is that I'm going to make this water a little bit lighter, and I'm going to make it lighter up here as well and darker down in this area. So I'm going to, again, stay thin. Oh, clean my brush a little bit. Don't want too much green in there. And say I'm going to go darker in this area. Yeah, lighter here, as I said earlier. Need to make this a little bit lighter. Yep, it's too dark. And of course there'll be a separation, a line that separates, because water will be coming through here. And so by putting a line there, I'll remember what's water and where's the bottom of this granite cliff that runs right here. And here's that little, you know, I'm gonna, again, this is what's so good when it's thin. I'm going to move this thing further forward. It's all in the same plane right here. I don't like that at all. So I'm going to make that water. This is going to be water. Nice, clear, beautiful Pacific Ocean water. And I'm going to move that little shrub of a tree closer to the bottom, right in this area. Right here. There. Yeah, that's better. And I'm going to reestablish the trunk here. And I said this trunk was going to be lighter, but actually that comes much later. That comes hours from now. But for now, I'm going to just make sure that it's reestablished as well. As I'm painting, sometimes one of the things that happens is that it gets painted onto, and there. Okay, those are the things I was thinking of, and I think that was a good move. I said this is going to be lighter up here, and so I'm going to do that. I'm going to take my cerulean blue, little alkyd white, cerulean blue, and you can see that orange, that underpainting orange with the death cut on the gesso coming through. And a lot of times, gosh, I like that. I really do. Here. There. Does that make sense? Yeah. Now, I'm going to have to develop this. Looks like an enormous ball. I'm going to have to cut into it, maybe make it smaller. I will refer to not only my color sketch, done either in oil or in colored pencil, but I will look at the photographs that I've taken to come up with this. And that's one of the other things that's really critical. This composition right here didn't come in a single photograph where this tree and this tree and this group of trees were kind of presented to me. There were plenty of paths at Point Lobos. But you'll see the photographs that I've used to come up with this design. I think that's going to be really critical, because what you see is not laid out as postcard perfect as this painting is presenting. There were shrubs and trees and bushes, and yes, there were some trees that looked like this and others that didn't. So it's very critical that I show you the photographs that they came from. I'm going to add a little highlight so we know that's where we're going to have it. A little bit of it now, maybe, in fact, more of it later, of waves that are kind of coming in and kind of making for the highlights. Probably the lightest lights that we're going to have in this painting are going to be from the waves that have rolled in and then kind of splashing on, rolling off of the rocks that are jutting out into the path of those waves coming in. And here is going to be that. It's not going to be as bright here as it is right here. Again, as I'm looking at this, I'm looking at this and looking at this and looking at that, and I'm saying, why don't you make this darker on the right-hand side, Carl? It really needs to be darker here. And it really bothered me why I didn't do that earlier, but I can seem to only be able to think of that I don't like this mass, and so I go back into it, take my cerulean blue, a little bit of cobalt blue, and say, yeah, I want to move into this area right here. Don't like this shape. It looks like a basketball or something, and I want to change it. And so me wanting to change it into something that wasn't there to begin with seems to be important to me, just so that I can say, yeah, I like the mass better. When this comes down right here to here, yes, that's good. I like that. It comes down here, there. It still separates from this darker piece, which I may lose in a minute, but then I'll reestablish it here. And I want to get those darks up into this area too. And a very dark near the bottom. I mean, this is where the darks really predominate. Very little light falls down here, so your darks can be the darkest down there. This is just a line to reestablishing the mass of this tree that runs up here. Okay, now, let me make sure that this trunk separates. It's going to be a lighter color because of all the background darks. And I did say earlier that I was going to add a trunk. I don't know if it's going to be light or dark. Let me put it in light for now. Just because this area needs to be broken up. And so maybe this is some material that is, and if you've ever been to Point Lobos, my Lord, there's so many shrubs and things or branches that have died and end up having an interesting mass to them, like this gray mass right over here. It's not in my sketch, or if it is, it was done quickly. Some people that paint and have painted for years have a set of colors and they never vary from it. And I'm not that way at all. And I'm hoping that people that are watching this video and are just learning that you experiment with colors, that you'll add another color just because it does something that you like. And so that's what I've been doing for years. I mean, if I were a minimalist, like Anders Zorn from Sweden, he used yellow ochre, used white, black and red. Those were the colors that he used, and he got some fantastic hues and values and colors out of it. It was absolutely incredible. Well, I've tried minimalism, it doesn't work for me, and so I've decided I'm going to use all the colors on the rainbow, and if somebody says, oh, this is really a great, this naphthol red is really wonderful, try it, and I will. And so I'm not a person who's a minimalist. I like using color, and so I will use whatever it is that gives me the satisfaction in the final result. And if it means trying a new color, I will, and I hope you do as well. So I've been thinking about this. I've made this lighter in the background, a little darker in the foreground. I'm still struggling with this area. I said that there are a lot of things that have died and turned a brilliant red. Let me show you. It's a fungus. I mean, you see that everywhere. And because I've been going to Point Lobos for the last 20 years, and it's a wonderland, and it's fascinating and strange, and you'll see a rot of some kind that's this beautiful orange. Now, am I going to leave that? I don't know. I don't know yet. How does it work with the rest of the painting, or does this have to be dark? It can take me a while to finish a painting until I feel I'm representing what I was looking at to begin with. I've used my sketches, pencil and oil sketches, to see is this really what I was looking at, and does it represent what I want to show people? And then I experiment, and that's why a lot of times it takes me a long time. In fact, sometimes I get a painting back from the gallery, and I've been thinking about this painting, and I wanted to try something. And then I try it, and either it works, and sometimes I ruin it too. But that's what I do. I don't like being kind of stuck in my way, doing the same thing every time, and without making changes. I need to learn new things. I need to experiment with things that end up making me a better painter, and I hope you try the same. Don't get stuck in some old way and then never change from there, because, I don't know, it gets boring. I want to keep my painting and my life kind of interesting, and that's why I'm bringing up this point, because I think it's of value. Yeah, you'll see me. I'm going to bring this mass to the left of that trunk, and you'll see me moving things around. That's not how they were in the very beginning, but that is how I kind of work with what I've got. Yeah, here. And I do, and again, this mass now is so dark that it kind of attracts attention, and it doesn't even let you go. It just kind of hangs on to you. I'm going to make it smaller. I think it's just too large. And so I'm going to go back in here. I don't even need to hold anything. This thing is down pretty tight. Yeah. Yeah. Here. Okay. Let me make an outline around it. That's how I usually do that. And say, yeah, this is where I think I want this. Here. Okay, so it's a little bit smaller. I'll go back in and kind of put that light blue ocean behind it, and then I'll punch in the tree. This is the sky. A little lighter, Carl, a little thinner. I've used the wrong pot here. There. That's better. Here. Yeah, I like that better. Well, I like it better for now. I do change my mind. Sometimes it actually is good that I change my mind, and sometimes I'm very sorry, but that happens too. just because I like that experimental, and what can I do with this that I didn't do last time? In other words, I'm not repeating things over and over again. In other words, if I do this painting a second time, or a third, or a fourth, or a fifth, it'll be different. These trees will be further out. Or this tree will be different. I mean, you'd think after I've done this 5 or 10 times that it would go easier for me, but it really doesn't, because I experiment and try things every time I do a painting, every single time. And that's what keeps it interesting, and it also doesn't make it, I'm not just copying things that I've done in the past. I can't do that. And getting some of this green to the sky is perfectly fine as well. Yeah. Okay. Now, this area over here is relatively undefined. In other words, a mass that isn't doing much. In other words, is that mass here? And is this stuff behind it here? Is that a different tree, or is that, in other words, I need to kind of be certain as to what is this? Is this part of the same tree as above, or is it totally different? And like I've said before, I will usually make a line that kind of separates the various masses. I'm going to go bring this one further down. Again, I'm not looking at a photograph right now because this tree is probably not going to be repeated in a specific photograph. It is just a very typical Monterey pine that you'll find at Point Lobos. Yeah, I'm going to make that lighter up here. This is still part of the blocking in process. We haven't, the painting is very far away from being a completed painting. But I need to do something here. I need to do something. Let me start up with a green, a bright yellow, a Rembrandt yellow. I did say earlier on, well, I like what I've done here. It's really, and I'm going to, I had a greener bush down here that I noticed I had on my original color sketch. Yeah, okay. In other words, I'm starting to find that this is a mass that I identify with. It's a tree, it's got a number of different colors in it. It's darkest on the bottom. The tree, or part of this tree, are kind of spilling onto this rock that's right here. And now, I like what's happening here. I need to make this thing goes in here, it ends up having some supporting branches that kind of pop in there. I like that too. This again, the mass, again, as you see me jumping from one place to another, that's typically how I work. I can't stand and keep working on one area. I need to do what I need to do to it, and then I need to go somewhere else. And then that makes me feel like, okay, I'm working at not just finishing this tree. Remember, I've said that more than once, that this tree is almost, the value is almost the same from the very top to the very bottom. And so I'm going to end up making this lighter and this darker on the bottom using colors that I've got, my dark sap, a little bit of red, and then go back in here. Here. There. Yeah, that's good. Okay, this is, doesn't separate, so I'm going to put that in front of it. That's the tree from behind. That happens to be a lighter juniper or a lighter pine or a bush of some kind, like this light green bush over here. And I do like that red that I popped in earlier. I'm going to leave it. And I'm going to leave it for now to think about, and I'm going to go here. I also don't like this round shape. I seem to have an aversion to just making round shapes. So I'm going to make a straight line on there. And I'm going to come in with that. The tree is going to kind of partially hang over this and kind of obliterate it. Yes, I'm going to make some highlights on there. Right here. Yeah. Okay. And I'm going to make this lighter on the other side. Lighter. Punchier. Yeah. You know, there's something else that's bothering me, this area being as open as it is. You know, I'll refer back to my sketch, both sketches. I've got water coming through here by having some blues in here, some blue of ocean water popping through here, and yes, I'll be doing that for sure. But for now, I want to bring something out into this area. In other words, my friend Ray Roberts gave a demonstration once to the California Art Club, and he said, you know, I like when I'm painting something that I'm looking through and past to something else beyond. And I've remembered that when he did that workshop, must have been 20 years ago. So I like the idea of stalks or part of this tree bush to have branches kind of coming out into this area, kind of obliterating it. Before, it was like somebody had cut a window and nothing was going to interfere with my view of the water right here. So I like this business. Hopefully I'll remember it as I'm going along and not obliterate it. In fact, you know, just for the heck of it, because this is so typical for me, is for me to take something and say, well, should there be a small tree in this area right here? And I'll be thinking about that and thinking about it, and then I'll say yes or no. I think it's yes, but that's for now. Let's see what happens as I'm thinking about this. Yeah, I do. I really think I need that there. And so that's part of the experimenting process. You look and you paint on different areas. What if I had finished this area and then I didn't want to add something? While it's still thin, you can do this. And it's no big thing to add a tree that wasn't in the original sketch or anywhere else, even in my color sketch that I did here. So I think that's perfectly fine. That's me, how I paint. But I think it's my search for perfection, to make a great painting. And that's the reason I do it, even though at times it does, it can bite you, and you end up having something that was nice before, and now I've ruined it. But I think that's part of the process as well. If I thought every time I touched something it was going to turn out well, it doesn't. And every artist knows that. Every artist has experienced that. And that's exactly how it is. But I think I like breaking up this opening that was here with these extra trees. So for now, I'm going to leave them. And now I'm going to leave them. And as I'm doing this, I'm saying, if that's the case, I think I need something down in this area, just like I'm doing now. It needs to be there as well. All right, we're almost done with the block in here. I'm just going to redefine some things, like this mass that I've just added, thinking it was a good idea. I still do. I just want to make sure that when I look at this in a little while, I'm still happy with it. So there's a mass here, one below it. There's also, I need another mass here. This rock just looks too contrived, and so it's actually in front of things, or there are shadows that are going to be casting over it. So we're going to have some shadows that kind of something is blocking that rock. We're looking again, like Ray Roberts said, past and through things onto something else. And I think that's what makes it believable. It makes it something that, yes, that's how it actually would happen in nature. Even though this red may not have been there, as I said earlier, but I've added it because I feel it's needed. Yeah, I think I can use one more of those, maybe. I had it earlier, but it became obliterated with this red color that I've put underneath it. But putting those things in, and they don't have to start at this line right here. They could start earlier. They could start from right here, and that's fine too. And some of them could be a lighter color instead of that dark that I've got, again, reestablishing some of those colors that we had in here. That is going to be something we'll do a little bit more of later. Let's see what else. Yeah, there's also this blue up here that I've had, which is ocean, cobalt and cerulean here. I've had trees there, and I can put them back. There's still some areas that don't have any sky at all, but that's all right. But for now, oh yeah, there's one more thing I wanted to do as part of the blocking, and I don't want to forget it, and that is that this tree, this little bush tree that I've moved forward from earlier, I want to make sure I reestablish its position and that it is important. And it is here in the foreground. Breaking up the masses, breaking them up, in other words, a large mass like this, I want to go in, and especially when I continue, I want to go in and break things up. I can't have a mass kind of be a, it's, I like it to be a solid, especially if it is, but I want to make it into something that's alive. There's light hitting it. There are needles in there. And the needles are, each one of them is catching the light. So how do I do that on a large mass like this? I'll go in and start playing with the various elements that are in here to make it a pine tree. My pine tree, because it's my reality. And I'm not here to copy a pine tree that I once saw. It's my pine tree, and I'm going to make it into my particular tree. Yeah, here's that lavender, which I like down below. I think we're heading in the right direction. And I think, here. Yeah. All right, I'm happier with this area right here. I'm pleased with this addition of this trunk that wasn't there before, the pine tree, a small one that's kind of growing out from this area right here. I like what's going on here. And now I'm going to think about this for a while, and then we'll get back into it.
In the world of landscape and plein air painting, painters and collectors hold the great California masters in high regard. For decades, artists have tried to understand the skills of these great impressionists, trying to master their popular style and feel. Imagine how much of your own paintings could be transformed if you'd be able to capture the feel and techniques of these California greats like William Wendt, Edgar Payne, and Granville Redmond. Now, you have the chance to learn from one of California's finest living impressionists. Introducing a new art instruction workshop on video, California Impressionism with Karl Dempwolf. In this video, you're going to reap the benefits of Karl's decades of intense study into how the best California impressionists created their timeless masterpieces. Karl will help you understand how to set your own artwork apart from all others. You'll have a front row seat for every step and brushstroke Karl takes as he creates rich, color-filled painting. You'll discover the best way to capture a scene with a pencil sketch followed by an oil study. Then, see start to finish how to complete a stunning studio painting with Karl explaining the what and why behind his paint application and technique, all setting you up for success when creating your own paintings. As a bonus, you'll get a segment on framing your paintings to make them properly fit the mood you're trying to portray. You're also getting an interview with the artist, plus a gallery show of his best paintings.
I've tried to change my style. I've tried to change it deliberately, and it's very, very difficult. So I'm painting the way I'm painting, and yes, Wendt has been a big influence. I like the masses that he develops. I mean, a mass of a tree or even a little road. It's a mass, it's a design that is so captivating to me that I've kind of taken that on. I've said, this is how I want to paint.
California Impressionism can be used by beginners as well as intermediate and highly accomplished painters who want to understand why Karl's paintings stand out on a gallery wall. California Impressionism with Karl Dempwolf. Available now on DVD or digital for your phone, tablet, laptop, or desktop. This is one video you don't want to miss. Order yours now.
Well, that video is called California Impressionism, and it's with the great Karl Dempwolf. You can learn more about the full-length video, the entire course, and he goes from plein air studies and sketches all the way through a final painting. Anyway, you can learn more about it at lilyartvideo.com. Remember, we have a special discount for today only, and you can find the code up in the comments section. Now, let's get right to our interview with this great artist, Karl Dempwolf. Welcome to Interview with the Artists. I'm Eric Rhodes, publisher of Fine Art Connoisseur, Plein Air, and Artist on Art magazine. Today we're interviewing artist Karl Dempwolf, and I should say award-winning artist because you just recently got a Lifetime Achievement Award from Plein Air magazine.
I did.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
So how did that feel?
It was overwhelming, Eric. I mean, being in that audience with 1,000 or more people in the audience and receiving something, and my only thought was, there are so many good artists, and am I really in this league? And it was tough. I mean, it was fascinating, and it was wonderful having John Stern there, and it was just really a highlight of my artistic life. It really was.
I think what we'll do is, at the end of this interview, we'll see if we can find the footage from either the presentation or at least the footage about the story of your life.
Okay, sounds good.
Well, that must be a little bit intimidating to think you're getting a Lifetime Achievement Award as an artist, I mean, with all these great artists.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. I mean, that's exactly my thinking. And it was literally overwhelming. It was just something that I wasn't expecting, and it wasn't something that I thought I deserved. I mean, when I think of C.W. Mundy or Dan Pinkham or all the other artists, and here I was getting that award, it was really unexpected, overwhelming, and I was very appreciative. Thanks.
Well, we were happy to do it, and of course the reason we did it is because your art is so magnificent. You've had such an influence on the art of California and the contemporary artists today, and so I want to talk about that. I want to get a little feel for your story and where this all came from. So we've talked about this a little bit before, but tell us again, you grew up in Germany.
Yeah, during the war we were in Bavaria, and that's kind of where we grew up, far away from all the conflicts that were going on all over Europe. And then after the war we ended up coming back north to the to where I was born, near Bremen.
Well, I think it's interesting because we were talking at dinner last night. You were in a part of Germany. Those of us who, of course, I wasn't around then, but those of us who see the stories about Germany, our assumption is that all of Germany was in these war-torn areas, and you were actually in a somewhat protected zone.
Yeah, it was agricultural land, forests. It was close to a lot of things that were happening, but in our area, there were no troops marching, except for the end of the war. I mean, as a young kid, I was 5 at the end of the war, American tanks would be coming on the main road through town, and the reason we thought of war and this whole world conflict was almost was an exciting time for us, because GIs would be throwing us chocolate bars and things like that, things that we hadn't had. So to us, it was like a circus show, you know, something exciting.
What age were you at the time?
5.
5 years old, yeah. So. And you were telling me a memory of the airplanes going overhead.
Yeah, that's one of the things that, and even then, it wasn't a war thing for us. It was just 1,000 four-engine bombers, Liberators and Fortresses, B-17s, would be coming over our area to head toward Romania, to the oil field at Plotzi. And this is the route they were taking. And so we were made aware of what was going on. The droning of 1,000 airplanes overhead is something that very few people have heard, and they probably won't ever again.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
So did you have any early art influences when you were in Germany?
Well, Bavaria is a beautiful place, yeah. And I think I was constantly reminded by my parents who, after we moved to back to the town where I was born, and then in 1954 we came to America, my parents would often say, "Karl, paint me something from where we lived in Bavaria." You know, she'd say in German, "Die Zugspitze, the highest mountain in Germany. I'd love to have a picture of it." And she'd have a postcard. And she'd say, "Well, go paint it for me, please." And so that was kind of how the whole thing started. She would ask, and I would kind of oblige.
So this is when you were what age?
Oh, this is before we came. I was doing that back in Germany already. And it continued when we came here. And when we came here, I was 14. And I have paintings from 1957, which mean about 3 or 4 years. I must have been 17, 18 at the time.
So you were painting before you came. So you were what age when you came?
14 when I came.
14 when you came. So you were doing paintings then?
Yes.
All right. And what were you using as your medium?
Oh, whatever we had. You know, it wasn't oil paints at the time. It would be water paints, or it would be crayons, or it would be anything to have me do a picture of something. And I don't know if it was a deliberate attempt on my parents' part to say, well, maybe he's got some talent and maybe we should foster this. Uh-huh. But I think it was just my parents wanting to have me do something for them. And so that's how it started, and that's how it continued.
And had you ever seen any art?
You know, I don't think I remember. We lived in a baron's chateau.
Oh, my.
Built in the 1534, 1535.
What was the name of it?
I don't know. I mean, I don't know if it had a name. And I didn't know it was built then until we went back, about 20 years ago. We uh-huh. went back, or even more, 30 years ago, we went back, and on the cornerstone of the building, 1534, and I remember the baron that lived there. I had a tricycle, and he didn't want us riding around the house to disturb him. He would still go out at lunchtime and shoot pheasant for his lunch. And so anyway, I have no idea. My sister might remember his name. I've forgotten it. But it was a, and of course, he got his income from the various farms that were being used by, sharecroppers or people who would end up using the ground to produce things for him.
So, but it's curious, you're living in a baron's house and the baron is living there. How is it that your family was able to be in that house?
Well, my father was an engineer, aeronautical, a machine bow, and he ended up being there because the government thought he was of value to the war effort. We must have moved there. My brother was born there, So we were there because the government said Karl Dempwolf Sr. is a valuable asset to our war effort, and he needs to be here, and therefore he gets to live in this chateau.
Well, not too bad.
Not too bad.
Yeah, so your father became a valuable asset to America because he got a job in in aeronautics in America, is that right?
Right. He engineers after the war, of course, were hoping to be employed, hopefully in an area that they were expert in. And aircraft industry was non-existent in Germany after the war, and so Lockheed had sent representatives in 1949 already asking if my father was interested in coming to America. And that all came from a program that started right in 1945 called the Paperclip Program, where engineers with Von Braun's rocket team, which the Americans were very interested in early on, knowing that the Russians were doing the very same thing. They were taking engineers and taking them off to Russia. Not willingly. They were promised, the engineers going to Russia, that they could work in their hometown in Berlin. And 3 or 4 months after they made that promise, there was a knock on the door. Those engineers were hauled off somewhere far into the interior of Russia to work for the Russian government on projects similar to the stuff that was being worked on here in the United States. But we came to paradise and they went to hell, you know?
So you came to the United States, you went to high school, you continued painting.
Right.
When did this kind of turn into something that you knew you were going to be serious about?
Well, I kind of painted continuously. I mean, it was, again, my parents asking. And then I was on my third career. I taught the educationally handicapped. I'd been a photographer. And when that photography, that aerospace photography and cinematography job ended, I had been ready to go into art full time. But it was something that I hadn't really planned. I was just kind of painting for the fun of it.
Had you ever thought about it?
No, not really, you know.
So you never even imagined yourself as a full-time working artist?
No, I was not. It was just so totally away from reality. But I did this painting for the fun of it, not because I think I'm going to get real good and do this for a living. It wasn't that at all. I just enjoyed it. And when my job did end, and I tried to get another photography position, I was already too old for most companies to decide, we don't want to take on somebody who's going to cost us a whole bunch of money on medical bills, and so let's not hire people like that. I mean, that's a typical business decision. I understand that. And so I made the decision I wasn't going to do anything else except for what I'd been doing for fun, which was paint. And that's exactly what I did. I painted then really seriously. In fact, I was already hanging paintings while I was working as the cinematographer and photographer for the aerospace company in Van Nuys, this ramjet company called Marquardt.
When you say hanging paintings?
In other words, I was doing paintings. My house was full of paintings.
All right.
And I took them to work and I said, you mind hanging this in your office and stuff? that's what I was
doing. So you had the bug.
I had the bug.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Yeah, I had.
So that must have been a kind of a tough discussion when you come home. You've got a family, you've got a wife, and you say to your wife, Diane, so I've decided I'm going to be a full-time artist. I've never sold a painting before.
Yeah.
What was that like?
Well, I think there was a transitional period there, too, before I ended up making that little comment about I want to be an artist. I had tried headhunting. You know, that was kind of a transition between being laid off and trying something else.
Right.
And I did that for about 6 months or 8 months. And then the stress of getting on the phone and telling somebody I've got just the job for you when I didn't. And I was told, this is what you do to be successful. You got to tell them you got just the job that they want. And after a while, I mean, I started developing a psychosomatic cough. Every time I get on the phone to try to tell people to come in, I would start coughing. It was awful. It was awful. One day I said, I can't do this anymore.
So really, if any time you're calling me and you're coughing, I know that you're not telling me the truth.
Right. Oh, that was a terrible time.
So then you went into full-time painting. So now what's that like? Okay, you now have some confidence that you have the ability to paint because you're hanging paintings around, but you're like, wait a minute, I've never sold a painting. How do you go from being a guy who's painted as a hobby to all of a sudden saying, I'm going to make my living doing this?
Yeah. Well, I think you need help at the time like that. You need helpful wife who's understanding, number one. It's got to be like that. Number two, you need outside help too. And one of the things that really helped me was the California Art Club, Peter Adams and Elaine Adams, who were starting to run the art club just about the time when I decided painting is going to be where I'm going to spend the rest of my life. So the art club and the members in that club was a great support for me, really.
What a phenomenal club. You're so lucky to live in an area where you have access to that club. The California Art Club is so busily doing so many things for collectors, for artists.
Absolutely.
And it has really been a phenomenon, because when Peter and Elaine Adams took it over, it was essentially dead.
Yeah.
It had been around for 100 years, but not much activity.
Right.
And they've just been dynamos in coming in there and just making that into one of the most vibrant clubs in America in terms of art. And what a fortunate thing for you to be able to participate and be teaching or to be participating in the sessions and things that they have going on.
When whenever they ask me to volunteer, to do a demo, to do help here, I'm more than happy to do that, because I really feel like I owe them. I really do. Artists are friendly people. They're always willing to reach out and help someone who's just starting. So hopefully that came through. I think joining art organizations, no matter where, and of course, like you said, I'm lucky to live in the Los Angeles area, and that the California Art Club, which was founded in 1909, William Wendt and Edgar Payne and those people in Laguna really did one heck of a job, and it's still around today. But it was dying, like you said. It was dying, and Peter Adams and Elaine Adams brought it back to life, and I was so happy when he said, "Carl, you got to join the California Art Club," and I did, and I've been a member ever since. And
so tell me about the value, because you're saying, you know, you need to be part of an art organization in your community. Why? Why is that important?
I think art organizations, ones that are well run, and California Art Club has chapters in San Diego and San Francisco, et cetera, et cetera. They're all over. And the reason it's important is because I think painting can be a very lonely existence. It's a lonely thing, especially if most of the art, the enlargements of art are done in the studio. You're not sitting there with a crowd. You're by yourself and you're struggling on your own. When you're part of a group and you're out in the field, you're part of an organization, part of a group of people that love nature. They want to be out there. They want to paint. And so I think there's all kinds of help to be had by people who've got more experience than you do. And you come over to their plein air study that they're doing, and you're asking questions. And they're never going to say, "No, I'm kind of busy right now. Come and see me a little later." People are open. People want to share what they know and the joy that they have in painting. So I think being part of an organization like that and the groups that kind of develop are great help to artists, especially those that are starting.
So you mentioned plein air painting.
Yeah.
You had been doing paintings, I assume, in your house.
Right.
When did you become a plein air painter?
Well, that really didn't happen until I met Peter Adams in the California Art Club. I mean, I really wasn't aware. Well, I'd been reading, of course, and I kind of knew Van Gogh was out painting in the open, and so were a lot of other people, but I hadn't really attempted it. And so when Peter Adams, when I joined the club, I became aware of going painting out on location, and I decided to early on that I wanted to be out there, not with one of those fancy schmancy new boxes, but I had my brother build me a wonderful little Prashad box that has a paint box and a wet box, and it's small and it's lightweight, and I've used it for traveling in the past. And so that's when I kind of discovered the joy of painting out in nature.
Well, I want to challenge you on that for just a second, because when you first start plein air painting, it's not a joy at all.
No, it's not. It's true. It can be tough.
Yeah. So can you explain to the viewers about the differences of what it's like to paint in the studio versus painting outdoors, and also the value of painting outdoors, the things you discover that you don't discover when you're in the studio?
Well, the value of painting outdoors after you've done it for a while and it's now no longer a brand new experience is that If you are a person who loves nature and you love the outdoors, by yourself or in a group, it's a wonderful spiritual experience. For me, it always has been. Mm-hmm. I mean, to be outside is to be in the presence of the Creator. It just seems to be that way to me. And I get great joy in doing that. But when you start, and you've got a million objects in front of you, and you've got, and I started, when I did planar early, I started with boards 16 by 20 or 14, 18, way too large, because it would take me forever to get done. And I would have to go to the same spot again next week or take a photograph and use it to try to finish the painting that I started on plein air. So for me, that was always very frustrating. And eventually I decided to reduce the size so that I would have only limited space to put in all the millions of objects that were in front of me. And I had to decide on 5, 6, 7 objects, trees, sky, foreground, a rock here and there, and that would be all the information I would be able to put onto a canvas. And then it became easier over time. I mean, the paintings started looking like my paintings, not like somebody who was just barely starting out and didn't know what he was doing. So,
right.
So to me, it was it took some time to develop that idea of painting smaller, and I think 8x10 is a good size on location today, you know?
So what do you discover about painting the first time that you go plein air painting or soon after, because you start seeing things that you don't see from a photograph or in the studio?
Well, one of the things that I seem to just enjoy what I'm doing, and I think I've got a decent painting that I'm working on, Eric, and then I get back home to the studio and I'm wondering, what was I thinking? I mean, why was I so ecstatic about what I was doing out there? And now I'm looking at it in the studio, and it's absolutely a terrible piece of work, but I was enjoying it while I was there. So one of the things that can be very deceptive is that you're feeling wonderful about being out in nature, and you're putting paint down, and you're mixing your little on your little Prashad box, you're mixing the paint, and all seems to be going well. But then when you look at it in a different light and the emotional, spiritual impact is now behind you, you're looking at it realistically. Is this something that I want to enlarge? And it's obvious that it still needs some help before it becomes a piece that I can enlarge.
Yeah. So a lot of painters will say that they discover, if they've been a studio painter, that they discover the range of form and light and color is a lot different once you start painting outdoors, because it kind of changes your perspective on things. Did you find that to be true?
I find that the hardest part in making the enlargements in the studio from a small sketch is that is the toughest part, trying to make it look as if I'd done it outside when I hadn't. In other words, a small 8x10 or 5x7 sketch is in front of me, I've got some photographs, and that impromptu, loosely done, quick sketch that I've done in 30 minutes or so outside is now a joy to look at after I've fixed it. And now I'm trying to get that same feeling, that same emotional impact into the enlargement. And that's the toughest part.
That's not easy to do.
It's not easy to do at all. It's not easy at all. It's
so
tough.
So what's your process when you first go out painting? Do you just set up and start painting? Do you absorb the nature? Do you make sketches? What do you do?
Well, I go out and sit someplace. I like to sit when I paint. I've seen pictures of Hansen Putoff sitting down and painting, and so I said, if they did it, I can do it. For years I stood, but I'm now a sitting plein air artist. And so when I go out, and it depends, am I on my own or am I with a group? In either way, I'll sit down someplace where I say, no, this is a wonderful little vista. I think I'll be able to make a sketch out of this. I sit down, and just like William Wendt and Edgar Payne, they all sat down and they first made a pencil sketch. They did. And those pencil sketches are a treasure. I own some of them of William Wendt's
pencil. Oh, do you really?
Sketch. I do.
Oh,
a lot of his color sketches that were part of it have been taken out and sold by someone else, but I end up having some of his color notes as to what this should be, how green or how dark and what have you. So So I do make a pencil sketch when I start off, very small. And when I travel, I try to take colored pencils along to kind of give me a hint as to what the color was.
So you're not traveling with paints, typically?
I used to, but it's such an annoyance today to have to pre-ship things and then look for terp when you're in some remote location, and it makes it very tough. So,
well, you know, there's a lot of alternatives now.
Yes.
For instance, there's the oils that you can use with water.
Right.
And what I've found is I've been taking gouache, which is different than watercolor, not much, but gives me a thicker feel,
yes,
and then I
does.
Don't have to go look for terps.
Yeah, the minute it says oil, TSA is going to say, oh my, sir, this is going to be something that'll explode. And they'll have you take it out.
Oh, you just need to be more adventurous.
Yeah, right.
I take oils all over the world.
Do you?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, but I've lost a few from time to time at TSA and other places.
Oh, they've taken my tripods, too, little tiny tripods. In fact, it was right after, pretty soon after the bombing at 9/11.
Yeah.
And so I was going to Europe to paint, and I took my paints with me, and they grabbed the tripod, that little tiny tripod, and they took it. It was going to be a weapon that I could use, and so they took it.
We have a thing. We have a website called paintoutside.com, which is for anybody who wants to kind of learn to paint. Right. There's some free lessons and things. And there's a sticker in there. It's a PDF that you click on, and then you print it out, and then you stick it on your paints. And it says that this is vegetable-based artist colors, and so it's helping people transport their paints. So, yeah, I want to go back. You were talking about William Wendt, and very fortunately have one of his sketchbooks, which I think is pretty cool.
Yeah,
Wendt was obviously a huge influence in Southern California art, as was Granville Redmond and others. Who were the biggest influences in terms of how you developed your style? And I must say, what I love about your style is it's your style. You don't look at that and go, oh, he's trying to copy this person or that person.
Yeah, that's always been something that's been in the back of my mind, that people would kind of think that because William Wendt or Edgar Payne have been a big influence in my life, that people would say, oh, he's just copying in their style. But I've tried to change my style. I've tried to change it deliberately, and it's very, very difficult. So I'm painting the way I'm painting, and yes, Wendt has been a big influence. I like the masses that he develops. I mean, a mass of a tree or even a little road. It's a mass, it's a design that is so captivating to me that I've kind of taken that on. I've said, this is how I want to paint. Just like Mary Cassatt, when she looked in the window of Durand Ruel and saw Degas in the window, and she said, that's how I want to paint. And when I saw Wendt and Payne and Hansen put off, that's how I wanted to paint.
So if you had a chance to meet these guys and you could ask them any question, what would the question you'd ask be?
Well, I think... of William Wendt, first of all, he named all of his paintings in some kind of a spiritual or religious way, where nature's God hath wrought, sermons in stone. I think he became a devout Catholic because of a marriage to his wife, and later on he ended up converting to Catholicism so he could be buried next to her. So I think he was a spiritual man, and I think he felt a lot of the things that we feel when we're out painting on plein air, that you're surrounded by grandeur, you're surrounded by the Creator's creation, and he was going to give thanks for being able to sit out in nature and create things that people just adore. And I think he felt that. And I think I feel it too. I really do. I think that's, and I'm not trying to tag on to Mr. Wendt, but I do feel that deep down, that painting out in nature and creating my art is a deep spiritual thing. It really is.
Well, you know, the Russians, there's a big plein air heritage in Russia.
Yes, there is.
And the Russian painters that I know are all very spiritual people. Most of them are Russian Orthodox. Right. And they actually have told me that when they're doing a painting outdoors, it's an act of prayer. That they actually consider the entire process a meditation and a prayer.
Absolutely. I mean, I feel that every time.
Yeah.
Every time. Even no matter where, that's how I feel.
Well, and there's a spiritual quality to your sketches. I had the pleasure of seeing some of the sketches in your pochade box, mm-hmm. your little plein air easel, and they're so juicy, there's such thick paint, so wonderfully, I wanted to say wonderfully rendered, but not really rendered, in the sense that, you know, they're not tightly rendered, but they do have this, almost this spiritual quality to them.
They do, and that's how I feel.
Yeah.
And then my connection to the Russian plein air artists, I've got the same Prashad box or the same paint box that Nikolai Timkov had. In fact, in the pictures of Timkov going out into the countryside in the snow of, I think he was in near Belarus or someplace, I'm not sure exactly where in Russia he painted, but he ended up having the same Russian box that I've bought when Dan Pinkham was selling them.
Oh, really?
Years ago. It's a wooden box with aluminum legs, and if you lose the little screws...
It's called a Yarka.
The Yarka box. They make the Yarka linen as well, which I use for years to glue onto my boards to paint on and stuff. Yeah, so I feel very much connected to the Russian plein air painters.
Well, one of the great gifts or experiences of my life has been to spend time in Russia mm-hmm. and to see these paintings from people like Levitan and Shishkin and others, to see them in person, and some of them are, of course, massive. Repin.
Grubar.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. And a lot of them, you know, never hit America. A lot of them you never get to see in the American Museum's fashion, very much so. You see him around. But the quality of painting is
incredible,
the level of training. So when you're training people, because you do some workshops,
I do
some training, what are you trying to really help these people understand? Maybe for our audience today, some of the core essentials that you think people need to master before they go on to other things.
Well, they have to have a love for wanting to do it.
Yeah, that's critical.
It's critical. You want to do this. And you've got to be prepared for frustration, because the first 6 months or a year could be very frustrating. And I remember when I started off and things weren't going right, occasionally I'd break a brush. I haven't done that in 20 years, but in the beginning I did. And so people have to be ready to be frustrated for a while. I think that if they love the idea of drawing and sketching and they've been trying it and they want to get some help, there are books available. Kevin McPherson's Adding Light and Color to Your Paintings is a wonderful book. More complicated and less instructional is probably A la Prima, but they're all good
things. A la Prima by Richard Schmidt. And by the way, there's a new version of it. He's redone it with new images and more. It's fabulous.
So you need to want to learn. The instructor can only do so much. You end up having to reach out and get books by Kevin McPherson or Richard Schmidt or other people and really delve into it. It's not something that... Yeah, you can do it on the weekends after your 8 to 5 jobs during the week, but you need to want to do it. And so you need to read and study up and practice. And the practicing is to make simple sketches of when you're sitting outside. What am I going to include? Do I include things from the right, from the left? What do I do? What do I eliminate? And most of the things that are in front of you, you will eliminate. Mm-hmm. So it becomes a matter of you deciding what's important. What do I want to include, and where do I place these things? I mean, you don't want to just make a copy of what's directly in front of you. You want to be able to design something that ends up looking like you might be happy with it when you're done.
Now, a lot of the people who are watching this right now are wondering, what's it really like to be an artist who makes his or her living as an artist? How would you define or articulate the artist life that you're living? And how does it differ from maybe what you were doing before?
Oh, it's so totally different. You have to become a man who kind of runs a business, because you're not just drawing and painting and then hanging them on the wall at home. You want someone to buy them.
Right.
And so you end up having a relationship with a gallery, or more than one gallery, and you need to form a wonderful relationship with them. If you don't have a good relationship with them, it may end up in tears, which it has for many artists. I mean, there are horror stories out there. So it becomes, you're changing your life. Unless you were a businessman before and you kind of have a business mind, it'll be a lot easier. If you're an artist and you kind of give your paintings away, then this may be a tough transition. It really might.
Right.
But I think with art club people, because a lot of them have been going through this for a long, long time. And that's a great place to find out, how do I do this? Who do I talk to? How do I protect myself, etc.
Now, you're also, that's the business side of the artist, which every artist has to have if they're going to sell their paintings.
Yes.
Of course, they don't all want to do that.
Yeah.
What's the romantic side? What's that like? I mean, are you like hanging out with other artists all the time? Are you traveling the world? Do you have a routine? What's that like?
Well, I do like to hang out with artists. I do. Peter and Elaine have been, like I've mentioned before, they've just worked tirelessly to get us to go out and painting together. And so they have a relationship with the Tejon Ranch, just north of Los Angeles, 250,000 acres, 3,000 miles of dirt road. And it goes from dense forest to cattle to vineyards and orchards. I mean, it's incredible.
I'm coming.
I'm telling you.
You call me.
I'm
coming.
It's one of the great. And of course, I think the company, the Tejon Ranch, the people themselves, they have their own agenda, which is, we need to make people think this is a friendly, an artist-friendly area. So come and paint. And so we can literally go anytime we want. And we can go almost anywhere we want. I mean, the choices are so incredible but they want to develop part of this land. This is about an hour and a half north of Los Angeles. It's close enough to LA to say we can build million-dollar homes. Each one is on an acre or two. And we can build 30 or 40,000 homes, and it makes a small dent into 250,000 acres. But that's what they're thinking, is their long-term plan. But even then, listen, if that's their plan, and they're going to let me come and paint in their area, and if you've seen some of the oak forests that are there, you think that you're in another world. It is just absolutely in the most incredible area.
Well, it's also close to LA. What's also wonderful about doing that is that you're documenting what might soon be developed.
It's true.
And I know that Dan Pinkham does this a lot in his area outside of Los Angeles, where he's documenting the lands that have since been developed. Right. And I think, you know, you go into the museums. I was in a museum in Canada recently, and they were showing pictures of what the area looked like today, which was filled with houses. And then there were the paintings of the pristine, beautiful land, and how these paintings preserve that, which is absolutely wonderful.
I think going there as a group is fantastic. And of course, Alexi Steele comes along and
entertains everyone.
Stephen Marich, and we're all. And then they've actually had us over and had us staying in their hunting lodge.
Oh, wonderful!
Which is a primitive hunting lodge. But they brought people along from the Tejon organization who would cook for us. I mean, it's been absolutely
fantastic.
You need to come out.
I will do that. So I want to mention just briefly, Karl has a couple of books. This one is about your plein air studies.
Small sketches.
And it's absolutely beautiful. And so there's also a book which is just a stellar book. And this is Karl's book on essentially your life's work, the big paintings and so many others. And congratulations, they're
Thanks
just both spectacular. And we'll make sure that they know how to find these. I will. They can find them on your website, which is right. Probably what, karldempwolf.com?
It's karldempwolf.com or netmonet.com.
Netmonet.
I've had that forever.
Okay. All right, terrific. And then we'll probably also make them available on our website so that people can get them there. Karl, thank you again so much for being here and for inspiring us all. I'm Eric Rhodes, publisher of Plein Air, fine art connoisseur, and artist on art. Thank you for watching.
The year was 1939. Hitler's forces were raging across Europe. World War II had been going on for almost 3 months. In the small town of Delmenhorst, Germany, a child, Karl, was born to Karl Heinz and Martha Dempwolf. When young Karl was 3, the family, including younger sister Barbara and brother Jörg, moved to Bavaria in southern Germany, where Karl saw almost no evidence of the hardships of war, and where the family lived peacefully until the war was over. The only evidence of war young Karl witnessed was American soldiers driving tanks through the town, throwing chocolates and chewing gum to the children. His eyes were open to the devastation of war when the family moved back to the north of Germany, traveling in an open cattle car and seeing bombed-out cities along the way. In 1949, Lockheed Aircraft interviewed several German engineers, including Karl's father, and invited them to emigrate to America. And after saving the money for the move and a stormy passage at sea, the family stood on the bow of their ship, the SS America, seeing the Statue of Liberty for the first time. It was a moment young Karl, then age 14, would always remember. As his family lived in tight quarters with his mother's sister in Irvington, New Jersey, young Karl was put into second grade English for half of each day, reading Dick and Jane books, and in the seventh grade for the rest of his lessons. His first airline ride in a Lockheed Constellation happened soon after, when his father moved the family west to work for Lockheed in Los Angeles. To become a true part of the family's new home, Karl started a newspaper route to make extra money. Karl grew and grew and played basketball for Coach Jim Mercer at Van Nuys High School and later tennis at the local junior college. But his passion was fencing, which led to his becoming the very first All-American athlete at Cal State Northridge. But it was when choosing his required elective classes that Karl hit the jackpot. Not only did he enter an art class with master artist Hans Burkhardt, that's where he met his future wife, Diane Holzapfel. But art was not his passion. Travel, teaching, and photography became his big dream. So he went to the Art Center College of Design in Los Angeles to study photography. Soon, he was shooting weddings and working on educational films during summer recess. Painting became a hobby, and Karl loved giving paintings to friends and family. In 1970, he married Diane at the Bel Air Hotel in Los Angeles, and in 1979, their daughter Theodora was born. Karl landed a job doing photography for Marquardt, a small aerospace company in the San Fernando Valley, where he worked for 20 years. His painting was turning into more than a hobby, and around 1980, he met Peter Adams at an exhibit at the Morseburg Gallery. Peter recognized Karl's talent and encouraged him to join the California Art Club, one of the oldest art organizations in the country. Karl began painting with the intention of making a living. Thankfully, with the help of his wife, now Dr. Diane Dempwolf, PhD, who was working hard administering educational programs and teaching at the local university, Karl had a chance to focus on his new craft as an artist. To spread his name, Karl would participate in quick draw competitions and street fairs, and even receive recognition in some art magazines. But he really got noticed when he participated in various California Art Club events. His first exhibit was 20 years ago, on the walls of Mission San Juan Capistrano. Over the next decade, Karl would participate in many joint and solo exhibitions at museums all over the country. Recently, Karl had an exhibition of 50 paintings in Santa Barbara, California. Not only did he create the paintings, he and his late brother Jörg made most of his frames throughout his career. On the back of most of his paintings, Karl will leave a note telling the buyer where it was painted or why he painted it, and what it was that made him stop and decide to paint it in the first place. According to Karl, it is usually an emotional connection, something that rings true in my soul. The same feelings I get when painting en plein air. I try to express these same feelings in the larger paintings done in the studio. At this point in my life, although producing art that I can be proud of is an ongoing struggle, the satisfactions are great, and my passion for painting only becomes stronger with each passing year. Karl Dempwolf is not only a painter's painter, held in high respect among his peers. His work is held in some of the top collections in the world. He is an inspiration to us all. And today, Plein Air Magazine is proud to honor Karl Dempwolf with the coveted Lifetime Achievement Award.
Well, that is Karl Dempwolf, one of the great living California Impressionists. As a matter of fact, the video is called California Impressionism. That's a great style, and you can find out about the full-length video at lilyartvideo.com. Remember, we have a special discount code for today only, and it's in the comments section. Well, thank you for watching. We have a free video for you. It's called 97 Amazing Painting Secrets from the World's Best Artists. We hope you enjoy it. It's our gift to you. Just go to 97tips.com. And I want to say thank you for watching today. Make sure you hit the subscribe or follow button if you're seeing this for the first time. We're on every day at 3, and I'll see you tomorrow.
In the world of landscape and plein air painting, painters and collectors hold the great California masters in high regard. For decades, artists have tried to understand the skills of these great impressionists, trying to master their popular style and feel. Imagine how much of your own paintings could be transformed if you'd be able to capture the feel and techniques of these California greats like William Wendt, Edgar Payne, and Granville Redmond. Now, you have the chance to learn from one of California's finest living impressionists. Introducing a new art instruction workshop on video, California Impressionism with Karl Dempwolf. In this video, you're going to reap the benefits of Karl's decades of intense study into how the best California Impressionists created their timeless masterpieces. Karl will help you understand how to set your own artwork apart from all others. You'll have a front row seat for every step and brushstroke Karl takes as he creates rich, color-filled painting. You'll discover the best way to capture a scene with a pencil sketch followed by an oil study. Then, see start to finish how to complete a stunning studio painting with Karl explaining the what and why behind his paint application and technique, all setting you up for success when creating your own paintings. As a bonus, you'll get a segment on framing your paintings to make them properly fit the mood you're trying to portray. You're also getting an interview with the artist, plus a gallery show of his best paintings.
I've tried to change my style. I've tried to change it deliberately, and it's very, very difficult. So I'm painting the way I'm painting, and yes, Wendt has been a big influence. I like the masses that he develops. I mean, a mass of a tree or even a little road. It's a mass, it's a design that is so captivating to me that I've kind of taken that on. I've said, this is how I want to paint.
California Impressionism can be used by beginners as well as intermediate and highly accomplished painters who want to understand why Karl's paintings stand out on a gallery wall. California Impressionism with Karl Dempwolf. Available now on DVD or digital for your phone, tablet, laptop, or desktop. This is one video you don't want to miss. Order yours now.